Quantum focuses on the physics of the very small, so think electrons orbiting a nuclei. An electron orbiting a nuclei is what we call a particle in a box. But quantum doesn't really happen on the macro scale. So past your electronics, we don't really have a sense of intuition of it, we don't see it, we don't interact with the quantum world. Okay, one of the biggest differences between quantum mechanics, E&M, and classical mechanics is that E&M and classical mechanics are deterministic. Quantum is probabilistic. I'm just going to put the word here. That word. Quantum is probabilistic. It depends on probabilities. So when we see something deterministic, when you think about on the macro scale, if I tell you that chair is there, you have a clear understanding that this object is in this definitive space and it starts and ends here. When we move to dealing with wave functions and probability, things get fuzzy. So when we talk about where does an electron exist orbiting a nuclei, we don't talk about a location. Rather, we talk about an electron cloud, which is the probability distribution in space in which that electron might exist. So in quantum, everything's statistics and probabilities. Something interesting is seeing how electrons orbit a nuclei and how that changes with energy levels. So in quantum, we have discrete energy levels, so N1, N2, N3, which are the allowed energy states. Another defining factor of quantum is the mathematics are discrete, which means that things can exist at specific levels, but not in between. We wouldn't say that time is discrete, we'll say that time is continuous. Because you can have infinitely smaller units of time, you can always talk about a smaller fraction of a second. In quantum, you don't get that. You can't be in energy level 1.5. An electron around nuclei is only in level 1 or 2, but never anything between. So it's discrete. So we say quantum is discrete and probabilistic. Another fundamental concept is the wave function. Wave function is a statistical distribution of energy or location. The first concept anybody that takes quantum mechanics learns is called Schrodinger's equation, named after Erwin Schrodinger. Okay, the mathematics is kind of advanced here, so I'm not going to go too much into it. Just point out a couple interesting points about this equation. So the main concept of this equation is that it relates a double space derivative to the derivative with respect to time. So basically we're matching a change of space or an acceleration to a change in time. So basically it relates to a particle's location changing along an axis as a function of time. Interesting thing to note here is the usage of I, which is the square root of negative 1 or an imaginary number. This is used to represent the phase and angle of a wave function. If it's squared, it becomes a negative 1, so basically changing your entire value to a negative, and this can be useful for some of the math done in quantum. Another fundamental concept in quantum is Heisenberg's uncertainty principle. Yeah, I'm sure everybody's heard the name Heisenberg from Breaking Bad. So Heisenberg uncertainty principle basically states that the more you know about a particle's or a system's energy, the less you will know about its location. So basically implying that there's a maximum amount of data that you can collect. And this is kind of due to that fuzziness that I mentioned about quantum mechanics. The more you find out about a particle's energy level, the less you'll be able to find out about its location, and vice versa. Okay, moving on to just a general couple of quick ideas in quantum that are fundamental. First is quantum tunneling. Quantum tunneling is the concept that when a particle is traveling with speed and it collides with a barrier, there's a chance it will go through, basically like teleport through, so penetrate. So that's called quantum tunneling. If you think of it in macroscopic scale, think of if you throw a tennis ball at a wall, there's a chance the tennis ball will travel through the wall, but there's a chance it will bounce back. So in quantum, this is generally used to represent a flow of electrons hitting a barrier in a circuit, and there's a chance that some of the electrons are going to break through the barrier, and that's going to lead to current leakage. And the more energy a particle has, the greater of a possibility of it penetrating a barrier, the thicker the barrier, the more energy it takes to break through. Another big experiment in quantum that I've seen mentioned a lot outside of quantum is a double slit experiment. Now there's a lot going on here and we're not gonna have time to cover it at all, but basically it's the experiment that proves the dual nature of an electron as a wave and a particle. So basically the general idea is that if you have, say, a barrier with two slits in it and you shoot an electron at it, you'd expect the electron to behave like a particle and go through one slit or the other, and then reaching a sensor behind the slit. So you would expect to see a distribution across the sensor relating to where it could possibly land. But what we find experimentally is that it behaves more like a wave of light. If you shoot in a single electron through a double slit, it will act as if it went through both slits and then interfere with itself on the other side, creating what we call an interference pattern of light. Light has a unique property that you can add it to itself, so a beam of light plus a beam of light can equal a brighter beam of light, or cancel itself out and lead to darkness. So on the sensor on the receiving end of the electron, it behaves like a wave of light, as if it had gone through both slits and then as if it been a wave of light interacting with itself. So kind of like what I talked about in an earlier video regarding the chip shortage, is the decreasing size of lithography used for chip manufacture. In semiconductors, in chip manufacturing, there's what's called Moore's Law. Basically, it states that we're able to double the density of transistors that go into computer chips every 2 years. And Moore's Law was put forth by one of the founding members of Intel. The issue is that currently we are, depending on who you ask and how you measure, we are between 4 and 10 nanometers across different companies and product lines. The issue here is that these structures are starting to get down to the atomic level. So at 4 nanometers, you're looking at tens of atomic layers. So the barrier is getting small enough that now there's able to be quantum behavior through these barriers. So basically, quantum behavior is becoming more important in the design and the behavior of chips. There's a lot of speculation that at some point chip design might hit a wall or slow down once as these quantum behaviors become more prominent, because it will just take a lot of re-engineering of how the structures and interconnections are set up because of current leakage. In response to this, government, academia, and the industry have started putting resources into researching quantum computing. It's a completely different architecture for how you make a computer chip and how you process logic. There's also spintronics. Current flow is an electron traveling. Spintronics is a traveling perturbation. So you have a series of atoms with a spin alignment, and then spintronics is communication or data processing by oscillating the spin field of electrons, creating traveling perturbations. But this is a whole other can of worms, and there's a lot to study here. So for quantum, we got wave functions, probability distributions, electron clouds, Schrodinger's equation, and Heisenberg's uncertainty principle, the double slit experiment as well. This is just a quick survey. You could spend a lifetime studying any one of these things.